So I come from Artificial Intelligence Laboratory at the Joseph Stefan Institute. And let me give you one slide of where do I come from. So Joseph Stefan Institute is the leading Slovenian national research institution. It has a bit over 900 people and researches in computer science, physics, chemistry, biology. Artificial Intelligence Laboratory has about 30 people, and we work in different areas of artificial intelligence, machine learning, data mining, semantic technology, text mining, computational linguistics, and so on. We also do invest our efforts into working with spin-offs or spinning off younger colleagues, which are enthusiastic for that. So you see names of a number of them. And we have also strong collaboration on academic area with European companies and European academia, as well as international. You can see some of our strongest academic partners listed there: Carnegie Mellon, Cornell, Stanford, MIT, University of Maryland, Karlsruhe Institute of Technology, UCL from London, and so on. We also have business clients, collaborators, which I mentioned. You can see some of the names there. And through the years, working in this area of machine learning, artificial intelligence, we have developed inside our group a number of demos, a number of prototypes implementing research ideas and research achievements we have. And here are some of the screenshots. And through my presentation, I will go through some of them, which I think are relevant, the most relevant for using machine learning and knowledge discovery for semantic web. And you see URLs, so you're welcome to try yourself later things, or if you have computer now. And this is a list of some of the European projects that we have been involved in. And here is one slider of our technologies. If we go from kind of more data, statistical machine learning, where we did work on statistical machine translation, cross-language information retrieval using statistical methods behind, then data, text, web mining, stream mining, and visualization, graphs and social network analysis, computational linguistics, social computing, lightweight semantics, and also deep semantics in collaboration mainly with PsycCorp, which is you probably know about a US-based company, but we did open a branch a few years ago, Psych Europe, in Slovenia, in Ljubljana. And video lectures is something which spans through all the research content that we have, and it's a web portal. So I have a few flyers, they're outside, and I can also pass around this for people to choose to check. And maybe also if you pass around, there is one brochure of a European project we are just concluding. So if someone is interested, you can just pass it around and check a look. Have a look. Okay, so videolectures.net, there are more flyers outside. So feel free when you leave to take them. So here's the outline of my talk. First, I'll give briefly motivation. Then we'll go into machine learning and ontologies, and I'll talk about two systems that we have developed, and one is Ontogen, one is OntoQuest. And then I'll talk about semantics for search and browsing. Again, I'll show you demos of several systems, SearchPoint, AnswerArt, and Richer, and search over sensors. And then, depending on the time, we'll briefly look into real-time data processing, which kind of grew out of Ontogen system on the top. When we, inspired by that, we started working with New York Times and after that with Bloomberg on mining their log files and how people access their web pages of reading their news. And then there is a recent effort of connected to that on personalized news search. And we'll conclude. So, I would prefer, if you have questions, to ask me to interrupt during the talk, so we don't have all to wait, because I know how it is. You forget what you wanted to ask for, or you don't manage to follow because you didn't ask. But I'll try also to have some time at the end for questions, if someone wants to ask more general question at the end. Okay, so for motivation, my personal background is in machine learning and knowledge discovery. About six, seven years ago, I started being more involved in semantic technologies, in the era of semantic technologies. And here are some observations and why do I think these two things fit together. So semantic web, semantic technologies, actually integrate many ideas on integrating existing technology, and it focuses on standards, on making things interoperational, working together, and introducing a little bit more semantics in what we have on the web. So we can say that semantic web is meant for machines to understand each other, if the usual web is meant for humans to understand what is content on a computer. So typically in semantic technologies, the approaches are top-down. So there is a domain expert that sits there, think about technology, ontology, how to conceptualize knowledge, writes the things. On the other hand, in machine learning knowledge discovery, we usually start bottom-up. We start from the data and try to find some regularities, some patterns in the data, model the data, make some classification, do something based on the data, how the data, what the data shows. So it's mainly bottom-up driven. And as you can see, these things kind of sound complementary. And we really try to do some merging of that. And there are many opportunities. So some are in ontology construction. You can think about using machine learning and knowledge discovery to help ontology construction. And we'll talk about that a bit later. Also integrating domain knowledge, where the methods can help machine learning knowledge discovery to reduce human efforts. Also handling data over time. If you have dynamic ontologies which are changing, driven by changes in the data distribution, changes in the usage of ontology, or whatever can change over time. You can also think about using machine learning knowledge discovery for supporting different modalities of the data, so it doesn't need to be just databases that we apply statistical methods on. It can be text, it can be images, it can be social networks or graphs or, you know, video. Also, machine learning knowledge discovery has found its way into language technology as supporting language technology. So from that point of view, since text and language is important for semantic technologies, we can see a role of machine learning there. And of course, if you have work which is top-down and manual by human, there is question of scalability. So machine learning data mining can help, at least with what we have found in our own research so far, with some semi-automatic approaches. So we can't replace human work, manual work, but maybe computers can help, can aid human in that work to make it more efficient or easier, or you know, whatever you want, whatever you manage. So if I go back to ontologies, ontologies are really one of the central objects in semantic web, in semantic technologies. They are used to represent knowledge. If you look from a viewpoint of machine learning or knowledge discovery, for us ontology can be seen as some structure, as some graph, which consists from a set of concepts. These are vertices in our graph. These concepts are connected in a way with some relationships, so these are edges in the graph, and then there is a set of instances assigned to a particular concept. So these are like data records assigned to vertices in a graph. And if you want an analogy to databases, you can think about an ontology similar to a database. You have some records, which are instances. You have some concepts, which are columns in a database. And there is some database schema, which is structure of your ontology. So once, from in our group, we started thinking about ontology in that way, we said, OK, we know how to do with graphs, so maybe we can do something with our methods. And then we were thinking about, so well, what is ontology construction? And we were checking different methodologies and defined one based on a so-called CRISP data mining methodology, which is methodology for data mining. But there are, as you can see, similarity with ontology construction. So if you want to construct an ontology, first you need to understand the domain. What is the ontology going to talk about? And then check what is the data you have, because I mentioned that we need some data for knowledge discovery and data mining. And then, what is the task that I want to solve? I can't solve everything at once, so I have to focus on some task. Do some ontology learning as a semi-automated process. And then, of course, you want to do evaluation of what you have done. You have human in the loop, which does a refinement. And in any of these steps, we can think about returning. You know, you can do the evaluation and human and figure out that you didn't really understand your domain well, so you have to jump back. Or maybe you didn't have sufficient amount of data and you need to collect more data. Or whichever step. Similar as in CRISP data mining methodology when you work with data mining. And then when we think about ontology learning, which was one of the steps in previous methodology that I described, again, there are different scenarios we can think about. So you can think about a typical scenario where you have instances and then you want to induce concepts. So it's something like clustering of instances, and I'll talk about that more later, showing this ontogen system. But you can also think about you want to induce relations between the concepts, or you are given an ontology, you already have an ontology, and you have a bunch of instances which you want to assign to the ontology, like ontology population. That's very similar, and we did actually address this problem as classification in machine learning. Ontology generation, where you want to generate an ontology from instances and some background knowledge potentially. Or ontology updating extensions. So you have an ontology, but you want to add more concepts, or you have new data which show some changes over time. Maybe you try ontology population, but you can't fit your instances to the existing ontology, so there is a need to extend it. So you can see there are plenty of tasks that can be addressed using machine learning and knowledge discovery. And if I just mentioned ontology population being addressed as classification into topic ontology. So if you look what is given there, there is a collection. In our case, we were working with documents, and it was organizing documents into a topic ontology. So it was classifying a new document into the existing ontology. And there are different classification algorithms that were applied on different data representation. Data is text in this case, ontology is topic ontology. So it talks about, is the document about sports or biology or computer science? And we were working on a system which methods, machine learning methods, how to deal with this large amount of data, how to do that on textual data, what is the feature selection, which algorithm to use, how to handle hierarchical structure of classes, and so on. And after developing the algorithms, we applied, we developed web services for Open Directory, DEMOS ontology, for INSPEC, and for Mesh medical ontology. And I just wanted to show one. I ran previously in the background the service for DEMOS classification. And let me see. Okay, so there's this one. So this is running locally currently on my machine. What I did was I went to the web page of Josef Stefan Institute and copied content of that page. In a window for classification. So this web page is my web page, and I asked the system, can you classify it? To which topic categories of DEMOS hierarchy it belongs to? So this is DEMOS, Open Directory, right? Hierarchy of web pages. And the answers I got is first assignment of keywords. So Josef Stefan Institute is about science, its institution, institute, social sciences, oceanography, which is iffy, earth sciences, and so on. So some of the things are correct, some are not. And then there are categories. So these are links to DEMOS categories to which this Josef Stefan Institute belongs to. So it's science, institution, research institute, which is okay, research centers, of course. It's also math, physics. These earth science and social sciences are not so, but environmental science is popular, and so on. So, you know, you can think about putting some other web page here and asking for classification. So Let me see. Just. So this is now the text I pasted in, which describes institute, location, and so on, and submit the query and get these answers I was just showing you. And I will also give URL and give some other pages and some other classification. Okay. Another thing, any question?
Yes.
Yes.
I was wondering, could you correct, like, you had this classification and it was there was some concept that wasn't so evident. And is it possible for the URL to just indicate to your system to reclassify with some information that could reorganize the topics, like in the way that would be more evident
of that would be more relevant. That would be in this version it's not, but that would be possible in the sense that there is a human loop in the story where the system is really used for this classification. That was done in another project where we had InSpec ontology, and that was a work with British Telecom, where their internal documentation was classified using InSpec, and then they were using the system in the way. Okay. So in this demo it's not, but otherwise, yes, it makes sense that actually you include the system. So for, I was mentioning data stream and constructing ontology from data stream. So we tested that on a stream of news arriving over time, and it was again ontology which you start constructing, but then based on the change in the news content you want to update it. And the process was such that it went through processing of the textual data by extracting name entities and using them as instances of the ontology, not documents as previously, by name entities. And then two name entities co-occurring in the same news would have their joint profile, would be represented as a features containing text which occurs around them. So you can think about two politicians being mentioned in the same news and then mentioned somewhere else, and then you collect all the context in which they are mentioned and you want to see if you can figure out a kind of relationship between them based on these words which are around. And this was on Reuters News. This is an illustration where we try to observe change not between politicians but between countries, how they are mentioned. And DEMOS was again used to help edit actually metadata here. So this is ontology which was on relationships between countries. So you can see here Europe, United States, Japan, France, UK, and this describes actually the most frequent content of the news where both entities were mentioned. So Europe and France were mentioned in the context of society, government, regional, France, European Union, while Europe and United States were mentioned in the context of business and the government and international business, trade, and so on. And then over time, that was a Reuters data from 1996, August 20, 10 days, and then getting the newer data from September 96, slightly changed this picture of in which context countries are mentioned together. And you could imagine doing that over a longer period of time and over different name entities and trying to figure out how relationships change over time. So this is a kind of going from text towards a kind of ontology, which is really more topic ontology, or stretching it a little bit in a strong, in a strict formal philosophical sense of what is ontology. But of course, there was a work of colleagues in the field of ontology learning from text, and there is a lot of that, ranging from there is existing ontology you want to extend. You want to learn relations, you want to construct ontology using clustering, processing text in one or the other way. based on semantic graphs, constructing ontology based on collection of news stories, and there is more information, and there is also an edited book available on the topic of ontology learning. So if someone is interested, there is a lot out there. And just giving you one example of our particular view, how we looked at that. And this is the methodology developed for semi-automatic data-driven ontology construction. So work by the colleagues, and it's available, the system is available on the web, you can download it and install on your computer. So what it does, it's semi-automatic, it means that there is a user in interaction with the system and system provides suggestions. It's data-driven, so there is some data that the user needs to provide, and then the system, based on this data, helps in building this topic ontology. So main features of the approach is that there is interactive user interface, so user can in real time make changes and see how it influences ontology, and there are concept discovery methods which are underneath, so there is machine learning under that, there is a clustering, there is a supervised learning, semi-supervised learning, which helps in naming concept, which helps in identifying sub-concepts using active learning. And then there are also keyword extraction, and there is visualization which is incorporated. So let me show you some screenshots of the layout of the system. So there is a data that you load in the system, and you start building an ontology, which is topic ontology. So there is a concept hierarchy which is listed there and also visualized here. And these are two synchronized views, so the same thing. And there is a list of suggested sub-concepts for the current concept. So this is selected concept, and it has some documents inside, and the user is asking system, help me to split it into four sub-concepts. And there are some suggestions that the system provides. And focusing on one concept is not just splitting it, but it's also naming it. So these are keywords which describe content of this concept, which are documents in it. This is looking into documents themselves. You can choose a document and read it and see if it really fits the concept you are interested in. The active learning I mentioned here is a story behind this. If the system can't really identify a concept you have in mind using clustering, then you can try to train the system. So here it was about wireless network. So the system couldn't identify concept of wireless network. You type in a query and you get examples of documents which the system thinks are about wireless network. And then you say, yes, this is about the concept I have in mind or no. And giving a few such documents, you give information to the system, you give labels if you want, and then the system learns the complete model based on these few examples. And if you provide more examples, hopefully this model of wireless network is better. So this is providing a few examples. It's active learning using support vector machine beneath, which is a well-known machine learning technique. And it's the other thing that the system has, I was showing you, is multiple views on the same data, which is introduced by using background knowledge in the story. So it's like, instead of just default view, you can have all the same news, you can have view which is more geographical or view which is content-based. So I want to divide my documents, news, based on what they are talking about in the sense of is it market, banking, government, or whether they talk about Europe, US, or Asia. So it's also possible by giving additional information to the system. And this is visualization, which is a visualization of all the instances, all the data, all the documents that you have beneath. The yellow are names of the documents, and white are keywords showing what are these documents in the area about. So you can see this cloud here is something about products, investment, and health, and the cloud up there is more on risk and management and reinsurance and services. And then based on this 2D map, you can also see how many potentially concepts are there. So maybe here you would say about three major concepts, and then I divide the data further. And there is also ontology population, which I mentioned, which is several existing ontologies have been transformed into classifiers, so you can see how your data will be classified into Eurowalk, ASPA, or OpenCore demos, which then hopefully helps. Is there any question on this?
One question.
Yes.
You said that you would start with initial data.
Yes.
Is this a core ontology? Like, are you starting with the core ontology and extending that with the data you analyze the data? Or how is the initial starting point construct?
Okay, great. The initial starting point is actually, so this is the system. The initial starting point is a folder of textual documents. It's just one document is one file. I'm loading them in. These are abstracts from 2007 Machine Learning Knowledge Discovery Conference, abstracts of accepted papers. And I was using that, I was one of the program chairs, and I was using the system to help me organize the papers into sessions. I was playing with it. So I'm loading in the data, these are documents, abstracts, right? And now it asks me if I want to do some linguistic processing. It's like stammer, and if I want to incorporate phrases, if I want to have some custom stop list for those who know about text mining. And now I have the data in, and I want to do a division. So I'm asking about splitting the whole data set into four subsets. I'm just guessing four. So it gives me, oh, the documents are about learning and trees and models and data and classification and features. So maybe I'm unhappy, I say, okay, five or six. And assume I'm happy with all of them. So I tick them, and I say add, and now they are added as subconcepts. Now I can go to one of them, I don't know, let's see, to trees, and I look into details. So it says it's about trees and regression and clustering. So maybe I just name it. I can name it the way I want. It's semi-automatic, but it suggests trees. So I do trees. Now it has named trees. And I can go into splitting it further, maybe in three subsets. It's about overfitting, about regression, and about institute tree. That's strange. So let's see two, maybe. Or four. So you see, I'm just playing, well, four is not good, right? But maybe I can stick with three and ignore this one because I don't like it. So I'll just ignore these five documents and go with the ones I have. So here I have threes and overfitting, and I can again name it overfitting if you wish. And then maybe I want to see what are these overfitting. What is in there, so this is now visualization of these five or how many documents are there, and I can see what they are about, or I can go and look at particular documents and read the abstract. This one was about some computation boosting methods are known to exhibit obviously something about boosting methods and so on. Any question? Okay. So that was on textual documents, but actually the system itself works on feature vectors. We represent textual documents in some way as feature vectors, so it can be something else. And we did apply the system on social networks, and we were based on a graph of who emailed to whom internally in an enterprise, we try to reconstruct organizational structure, which is informal structure. So you could imagine, based on that, you see who are the central people, who gets the most emails, who, you know, how people connect between themselves. We were doing that on data for research organization, and we figure out, which was good, that actually research departments kind of mostly communicate inside, but then there is administration which is in the middle communicating with all the departments, which is good. Otherwise, if the administration would be kind of isolated, then it doesn't serve the purpose, right? But then we also did start thinking about how about images. Images are also processed in the way that you do a feature representation. So you extract some features and do some data mining, and we are looking into extracting so-called SIFT features, and also color histograms. So now an image is represented with a feature vector here, with some numbers in there, and we just simply feed it to the same ontogen system with a little bit of adjustment. Now we don't have keywords, but we do have images. Actually, we don't have in previous, on that textual documents, we took, as a representative of a cluster, we took an average feature vector, you know, the most typical words, and here we took a medoid, you know, the image which is closest to the center of the cluster. And this is again enables, as previously, browsing text. This is browsing through images. As visualizing textual documents, this is visualizing a map of all the images, and if the two yellow dots are closer together, it means they are more similar. And since we have feature vectors, we can measure similarity, right? We know how to measure similarity of feature vectors using one or the other measure, but we know. And adding some images on the top of this map, you can see here it's mostly about some buildings and some flowers and some images of fire. And this is the first level ontology constructed using only images, and you see now these are not keywords but actually names of features which are the most important or most characteristic, but I can also show you some images of these top level clusters. And you can see, you know, this is flower, but the system thinks it's fire. These are flowers mainly, this is fire but gets into flowers, and some buildings and some more flowers and more flowers. And this is on the top level. And now I can go one level deeper, focusing on one of these. Actually, the first one, which was building, looking closer at it, it was mostly buildings, but there are also flowers in there. So I want to split it and some fire into more fine-grained subconcepts. So I do that here, splitting it further, and this is subconcepts that I get. So again, it's not perfect, but it works. Right? So it's just to illustrate that actually, if you work on sparse feature vectors, you don't need really to work just on text. If you can generate sparse vector from images, it can be applied as well. With machine learning methods underneath, actually, don't care what you are running on, as you know, as long as you set the features correctly, the correct distance to measure, and so on. Okay. The next work, which is connected to ontology, is text-driven ontology extension. It's just a few slides, and it's basically a methodology which is based on using data and extending existing ontology. And it is based on classifying, trying to classify new data into the existing ontology. So the process starts here, which is there are users which provide domain-relevant information. So we have existing ontology, right? User comes with domain relevant information, some domain keywords saying what is the domain that they want to extend ontology with, and possibly providing domain glossary or something. We did that on financial glossary. So you could imagine there is a glossary of terms and you have your ontology, and now you want to feed in somehow these terms into ontology. And you don't want to really go manually through the whole ontology, it's huge. But you still have to do manual work. I mean, you can't expect that the system is doing it perfectly. So what the system does first, based on the keywords and this domain glossary, it extracts relevant subparts of the existing ontology. Because I said it's huge, so it extracts subparts. And then out of these subparts, it measures similarity between the concept you want to add and the existing concepts in the ontology, which are in this subset, right? This relevant subset of ontology. And it suggests, it gives you a rank list of possible concepts which are similar to your concept, or they are maybe more general or more specific. So you're trying to find, really, if you come with a new term, I'll show you in a minute screenshots of demo, where is this term fitting in the existing ontology? So user validates and confirms, the ontology gets extended and reused. And the hope is by extending this ontology, you will be able to do some work better than without extension of the ontology. So I said it's text-driven, ontology extension, and the method uses content, structure, and co-occurrence. And the research experiments were about which of the three helps the most and how to combine them and so on. So that's a part of research story, how to do it. And the experiments were done on a site ontology in two domains. One is on finances and the other one is fishery and aquaculture. And then the best results were obtained combining these sources, content, structure, and co-occurrence, but not the same for both ontology. For one, structure is more important, for the other one, co-occurrence is more important. And these are the results. Let me just highlight so I don't get you bored too much with all the numbers. So this is for ASPA, this is for finances, this is for agriculture results. What I'm showing is a number of methods. So there is baseline, that's a method which is commonly used. You just compare name of the concept with the name of the glossary term you want to add in the ontology. So this is the baseline, and the bottom one is the proposed one, which is combining content and structure and co-occurrence. And this top one is showing, if I have 100 glossary concepts, which I, 100 random terms which I want to add, how many of them, in how many cases, the correct one was on the top. So if I'm using baseline, here it's a, for any relation, it's 37 out of 100. So it's 37% of the terms that I wanted to add, the system correctly suggested. If I use the proposed methodology, it's 84%. And on the other domain, similarly, there is a jump in managing to propose the correct concept at the top, correct concept from the ontology. And this is among top 10, of course, the results are even better here. Top one, you request that what system suggests in the rank list of relevant concept is always at the first place. And here you are saying that the first 10 I'm happy, because you know there is a user who is going to choose among that. So if the system narrows down out of the all concepts in the ontology, which you know can be thousands, then you know to 10, it's really good. And this is on the other domain again. Instead of 40, we get 98 out of 100 correct. So for the demo, it's just a screenshot. What the system, what the user enters is a financial test domain, which is a part of the glossary. And the system suggests out of, in this case, it was site, as I said. For this concept, concept is CBO. Collateralized bond obligation, which is some term from this financial glossary, and these are concepts which exist in psych. Obligation, tax obligation, chemical bond, bond agreement. So you can see it's not perfect. This chemical bond is probably not the financial bond, but still. User can probably easier look through that than looking through thinking what in psych is there and what could be. And then there is a different kind of relationships. Okay, that was about ontologies. Any question or comment? How are we doing with time? Can someone tell me?
It's good. It's for 3:45, so we have still 15, 20 minutes. For
okay, thank you. So this one is a little bit more on search. Usual search, you know about search. It's, by the way, it's again publicly available, you can play with it. So, what is the motivation behind this system called SearchPoint? That search engines in general work well, but sometimes there are cases when you can't really specify your query. It's, the system is really not returning what you want, and there is related work in clustering search results, ranking them differently, and so on. And this system is in that direction. And this is, I think, the formula I have on my slides, but I won't go through it. Basically, what it does, it clusters the search results into that 2D space visualization, and then you can change it. I'll show you them when you'll see. But let's first, you know, there are different search engines. If we type in Jaguar as a query, we get some answers, but there are 84 million more which you won't go through, right? Well, unless someone can organize them a little bit better for you or do something, you'll just go through the first screen. I do usually the first screen. Well, this is actually the idea of search point. So you type in Jaguar, and all the top, here in this case, it was 200. The top 200 return results by the search engine got clustered. And this is in this case, they are clustered against ontology, Demos ontology. And then you can move this red dot and say Jaguar, but I really meant science. I'll show you live demo in a minute. And then they got re-ranked. So this number here says the original rank of the entry. So you can see now what was originally on the 9th position is at the top. What was originally at the 59th position is now second at the top, and so on. So it basically enables you to look a little bit on this long tail, which was hidden there in this 84 million, right? And this is this conceptual map and the point we are using. This is another example, and this is what is behind. So what is behind is there is a query, and there is this was one particular implementation which was done for intranet search for Accenture. Using Sable, and there was this visualization done, and here is like context discovery of the user, soft filtering and graph drawing, which was happening behind. And maybe if I just show you, so this is the original Accenture interface, and this was just added. This was only this thing was added, like visualization. So here the user searches for smart grid. And originally, these are the answers. So introduction to smart grid, some PowerPoint. This is their intranet search, so documents they have internally in the company. But if you move this red dot and say, but I really meant businesses, smart grid related to businesses, these answers got re-ranked. And then this introduction to smart meetings got at the top, demo and info. Or if you move and say, oh, I really meant, I think it was energy or something, then it gets re-ranked again. So it's just re-ranking the search results. And let's see if the internet, it should work. So we can type in some, because that's Jaguar. Just there. Okay, so Jaguar, and then this is the red dot, which I can move towards sports, and you get Wikipedia sports car at the top, and Jaguar cars at the top, or I can move to International, Jaguar, or Jaguar magazine, or design, or something. Any other suggestion? What is behind is a usual search engine.
I think snow.
Snow. Let's see, and it's either doing it against ontology or just clustering from scratch. So another thing from those who are interested in ontology is that what I'm saying here is basically you can get view on the search results using different lenses, different semantic lenses. I want to look at my search results through the lenses of Demos ontology or through the lenses of ASPA, or, you know, we had a project with United Nations Food and Agriculture, and they were saying exactly we need that. We have people who are economists looking at the same data, people who are marine biologists looking at the same data, and they want to see things differently. And since they have ontology for each of them, you can think about projecting through the ontology and showing how the search results change. So here the snow was ski vacation package. Snow in Wikipedia. Let's see. There is games. Best games. Or snowboarding. Or snow news.
Ski.
Ski
if you look at something abstract like dimension, for instance, would it work? Or,
I don't know. It's usual. So I think this one, it used to go to Google. I think now it goes to, I don't know, maybe Bing. I'm not sure. But it's just re-ranking. So.
Is there a meaning behind the colors that you're showing here?
Colors, not really. It's just for diversity. Not really. Yeah, I know. Dimension. Wikipedia is at the top, but it can be what? Class dimension. What is that? Free online Java classes dimension. Color dimension. Printing postcard brushes.
Like, for instance, your work on doing 2D maps of concept, this should be extracted from the word dimension. Where do you have an idea where you put in that, probably? Is that the dimension? Or?
Which?
Yeah, well, that's where I'm.
Data dimension, yeah? Mm-hmm. Because, so one thing, if you do it through, let me see if I enforce the links, that used to be a nice one. Depends how you do it. So if you do it just by clustering, then it's also interesting to see what is in the data, what the system finds. Maybe you find some different aspects of your query which you weren't aware about. I wasn't aware of all these dimensions, right? And here A4, so it's even floating. It's interesting, A4 is such a big thing, which is you can see size is view, road, it's car, A4, but it's also A4 is, I don't know where is it, but it's also architecture and clothing and cars, so that's cars. Okay, anyway, I could play with that.
I tried on my computer, but
yes.
The result was different.
it's
really yeah, so it's possible that the search engine can take some cookie or something and does personalized search. Because this is just on the top of search engine. So, it's personalized, but not through here. Okay, another thing which is connected to search and semantics, AnswerArt. So, try AnswerArt, that's another search. AnswerArt.net.
On top of search engine too?
No, this one is not on the top. This one is on the top of Threepwords. Oh. So what it does is, the system here is what is visible. I'll show you a demo. So there is a question which goes to the answer art, and there is an answer. And the question is, I think potential Hugot injection. I have that on the slide. What is beneath is actually a collection of documents on which you want to do the search, which are pre-processed to get a triplet out of them. And these triplets are going through semantic enhancement using some ontologies. In our case, it was WordNet ontology in general, and then it was Psyche as a general common sense ontology, and then we had several domain ontologies. One version is with ASFA, another version is with Mesh from Headline, another version is with Reuters ontology of topics of news, and then you got questions to set questions, and it's like these documents are now biased toward the ontology content. So this is one who got injections. That was a question asked. These are just some demo questions which are on the page. If you don't know what to do, you just press them. It's in Medline. So I choose here Medline, who got injections, and these are the answers. So I have the following. So that was who got injection. So it reads received injection, patients received injection, mapping technique obtained injection. That's also an interesting one, we can see why. So it's not perfect again, but it does make sense if it's semi-automatic, if it's for the user. And you can see here, it's who got injection, but it's actually here received and obtained and so on. And that's due to, this particular is due to using WordNet. So in WordNet we know for the synonyms. And these are articles on which the claim is based. It's kind of justification. So why do you think rats receive ejection? Well, because it says here, and it says here, and it says there. So I can click on the document and see a document which talks about these rats receiving injection. And I can also choose their show document overview, and I see a kind of graphical representation, a summary of that document showing, and some of the facts extracted, which are extracted based on natural language processing, extracting subject, predicate, and object out of the sentences. So this said, rats receive injection, CBF reduced percentage, reduction persisted cortex, and so on. And you can see on the graph some of that. Another one I tried explaining with was what do sharks have? And there is again a list of answers. Sharks have undergone declines. Shark has tail, shark has specialization, shark has skin, shark has meat, and so on. And again, for this tail, I can look in the document and I can see how it's drawn. Again, using this same visualization technique for visual semantic graph representation.
It has to be questioned. It's a Joe Hardy.
It doesn't need to be a question mark. No, what it does. Let me see. Yeah, they have it here. Yeah. So, where is water used? That was another thing I asked, and it was like water is used in following ways. Yeah, so here is ASPA. One was this shark was from ASPA, which is agriculture and marine biology, and the other one with rats was from Medline. So where is water used? That was the one I asked. So he's using.
If you wanted something about the earthquake this morning, the earthquake in Japan, for instance, you would have to frame it as a question.
The idea is to frame them as questions, yeah, because the system does pre-processing to get this kind of triplet out of that water used X, the following, and then tries to match this triplet store. That's why the data was pre-processed for a triplet store. And of course, it's a demo, and it doesn't work always perfectly. And in some situations, this takes a while, or I don't know.
Just
a
question.
But,
sorry.
Yeah.
Back probably to this the same formula for question asking. If you put where and if you put what for,
yeah,
does it make any difference?
It does a little bit.
Yeah.
Not as good as for our question answering systems, which are tuned on that patterns.
Yeah.
Because there you can also tune on knowing that the number is expected, how much or something. So there are some of this. So this system wasn't optimized for that. We were aiming at showing how to get from text out triplets and do some question answering using completely different approach than the usual one.
There won't be any filtering of the triplets that are definitely not in line with the question word. I mean, where, who?
There is a little bit of that, but we don't exhaustively cover everything.
Oh.
We don't cover time, for instance, but we do cover some who and basically. Any other question? I mean, you're welcome to play with that, and you can always email me later and tell me. Another thing, natural language text enhancement, enrichment, again, it's publicly available. And what it does, this is a kind of little bit putting together the things I talked about. Their show semantic graph at the top is basically what I was showing you, this drawing of semantic graph, visualizing this document. This part is categorization into Demos hierarchy. And this part is actually entity resolution, I will show you. So the enricher system does first entity extraction and then entity resolution, where resolution means a core reference and upper resolution, but also linking to some of the existing ontologies from linked open data, and also some word sense disambiguation. And then it does this extraction of subject, predicate, object triplets out of text. And based on that, this visualization is generated. And it does categorization of a whole document. So it goes on a lower level of name entities, but also on the whole document content. And when I said entity resolution, this is just to illustrate. There are different research methods, and the research we had behind what we were doing that actually was then incorporated and made the demo become interesting for us was this research, which was if I do entity resolution, if there is a document which mentions Microsoft and then later mentions Apple, so these are mentions. And for Microsoft, this is my ontology, my background knowledge, I resolve that Microsoft is actually Microsoft, which is corporate, a company. So there is Apple. For Apple, it can be fruit, it can be a company. But since I have it co-occurring in the same document with Microsoft, which is a company, then the probability that Apple is linked to Apple, which is actually company, is higher than just without this additional information. Right? So there are some methods, co-occurrence and some structure and so on, which are used for this entity resolution in order to link the data into ontology, into link open cloud. And this is the process behind. So this is some text pre-processing, extraction of assertions, and then visualization comes on the top, which was this graph of subject, predicate, objects. But then also this integration, categorization, and also export of the data into RDF. And here is a potential name entity extraction and resolution that is also optional if the user wants to look at that. And this is just a table comparing what the system includes compared to some state-of-the-art available systems like TextRunner, OpenCollegate, and Nell, what they based on the different functionality. I won't go into details here. And this is a screenshot of the demo. So I went to Petco's web page. Well, and I copied the text in a window. And here is what I got. Now I know something more. He's a professor, and he spent year, whatever it means, somewhere, and has research interests, look at that. And he prepared, thesis prepared in RIA, postdoctoral fellowship, and so on. And these are, this is the text, and the name entities which were found back at Professor University of Montreal are also here, and system tries to link them to ontologies in link open data, a few of them. And then here are some keywords which are relevant for this page. And then we'll see some categories. So there is also a possibility to get some anti-graph out of that. And this is the graph. So it says, this professor has research interests. They include ontology engineering. Here is a little bit of research projects algorithms involving concept analysis. And this is this INRIA postdoctoral fellow prepared thesis. And I don't know what was that, some problems. Oh, probably application of problems to applications or something like that. We can also look into entities. So I opened one of them. They are not all perfectly resolved, but you know, here is the one which was connected to DBpedia and connected to OpenPsych. So these are details of it. In connection to OpenPsych, it just said it's an organization. And then there is a concept from Psych which talks what is an organization. Right? It can be referred to affiliate, agency, enterprise, and so on. And these are also categories talking about what is the content of his web page, his CV about. And there are science, academia, computer science algorithms, artificial intelligence, for instance, and then this is, if you click on this, it's linked to DMOS artificial intelligence category, right? And, I mean, I can show you that alive, but I don't think we really have much time. So this was another document, another visualization. Yeah, so this is the page. Grenoble, National Institute of Grenoble, then it opens Grenoble, connects also to GeoNames, to Wikipedia, to Yago, OpenSite, and then here is some semantics, some correcting, some errors, but basically that's the idea. Is there any question? Okay, I have just a little bit more that I wanted to show. One is opinion mining, and it's actually connected to what I just showed you. There, we categorize document into demos, but we said, well, it would be also nice to have a sentiment of the document. Is it a kind of positive, is it negative, or opinion, which kind of opinion is expressed? And this is a really ongoing work. We just started a few months ago with that. And the idea was, the use case is Twitter, comments on movies, and the idea was, in order to do opinion mining, I need to know which words are used when they express positive opinion and which words are used for negative opinion. And there are some of such vocabularies available, and there is also a version of WordNet, anti-WordNet, but they are general. The idea here was, well, when you talk about this particular domain, it's movie reviews on Twitter, maybe vocabulary is a little bit specific, so can we capture that? So we went to movie reviews and sampled from there two clusters. This was manually seen, just looking through the movie reviews, a human looking through the movie reviews, say weird, odd, are words which are used for a negative connotation of the review, and amazing, awesome are used for a positive connotation of movie review. For some other domain, it doesn't need to be. Maybe amazing isn't good, maybe it's, you know, it's negative. So based on that, this was used in training data. We trained opinion vocabulary, which is domain specific, and then this opinion vocabulary was used, applied on movie tweets to see what is the frequency of positive and negative tweets, and this is an output of the system. It's basically just showing you the frequency. So that's what it's showing. One thing is, this was a movie, okay.
Total Social Distribution.
Yes, yes, yeah. And it's a majority, so 73% of the tweets were positive, the rest was negative, and these are two lines of the frequency of positive. You can see this line is positive, the top one. This is the frequency of negative tweets with that kind of sentiment over dates, over time. And this is another thing, which is comparison of movies. So these are three movies, Inception, Avatar, and Eternal Sunshine of the Spotless Mind. What is the percentage of positive tweets on that, and what is the percentage of negative tweets on that? So basically, what is the idea there? The idea was domain-specific vocabulary in order to express opinion. And one more thing, which is a sensor search, which is not text, but it includes semantics. It includes a little bit of text, which is sensors. You can imagine there are sensors out there measuring something, they are connected to the web. There is a live demo I will show you. But you want to add some semantics on the sensors. One semantic is geofiltering on the location. You don't want just the longitude and latitude, you want more. There is an inverted index, which is built on the top for the purpose of search engine, which is on textual description of a sensor. It's measuring temperature or water or something, water level. And for the search, there is a personalized page rank, which is used as a technique behind. And the query in that, you can query based on keywords, and you can also show a radius of a location around which you're interested. And this is how it looks. So it's based on keywords and radius, you get more hits in the area which you are interested in. So this was water level. Let me see if I can show you a live sensor search. Yeah, so that was water level. And this is the area I draw as I'm interested in. And the ranking is A, B, C, D, that's just reflecting my ranking here. So you can see that sensors which are relevant, which are measuring water level, in the area that I'm interested in, are actually ranked higher, because there are also some other sensors. There is a sensor here and here and here. But they are ranked I, H, K, and so on. So they are not top ranked. So there are basically these two criteria. One is what is it measuring, bringing semantics, and the other one is in the area that I'm interested in. And in this domain, what we are looking at is semantic annotation of sensor descriptions using standard languages, SensorML, mapping them to ontology. And the other one is data. The semantic annotation of the data. So if, you know, water level, instead of giving exactly the value, is it low, high, something like that. And also aggregating new sensors. We did some experiments which were, I think, if it's a comfort level at the beach. So comfort level, we defined it. There is no sensor which measures comfort level. But you can say that's the temperature, if it's not too humid, it's not too windy, it's, you know, the temperature is right, then the comfort level is good. So you develop some formula which is then acting as a virtual sensor. So you put semantics on the top of these measurements which are in there. Okay, so how are we doing on time and questions?
It's 4:15. Take the time you need to win.
I can stop here, or I can tell you more about real-time information processing.
One more.
You want more? But I should do quickly, right? Okay. So this is something which grew, I mentioned, out of Ontogen. And actually, inspiration came from colleagues which were at the time at New York Times, and they said, we could use this Ontogen. If you can help us structure interest of our users to see what they are reading, and then if there is a newly emerging trend, and we did experiments with them, and it was on green technology or something like that, and they said that if you know that there is a user segment which comes and reads New York Times about that, we can try selling that to advertisers, and you know they are going to pay more if we serve their ads to a particular user segment. So that was a kind of little bit story behind. And it led us to so-called QMiner, a generic platform which we are using for real-time information processing, which involves some complex event detection and anomaly detection. So what happens there? There are some measurements, sensors, alarms, user logs of users reading New York Times. And then we capture this data and do some transformation and enrichment and do some modeling, for instance, for anomaly detection or for prediction or for complex event detection. So there was some of the components of the systems were put together for British Telecom, where they have a network of devices, about 25,000 devices. And they issue alarms if, you know, one device drops and triggers alarm as a domino block. So it's just alarm everywhere in a second. And you want to know one of the things they're interested in is root cause analysis. Who was the one to trigger the alarm? Or they wanted short-term failure prediction, which they were really interested in, and Borgsell, I should say, we are proud. And also long-term anomaly detection, you know, long-term saying something is going wrong there, it's probably not going to fail any minute now, but you should take a look. And there are two displays. One is analysis of the data that the operator does, and one is that they have a big board which is actually predicting what is going, which alarm is going to happen in a short time. And this is visualization of root cause analysis. The blue thing is prediction, and that, for instance, here, let's see. This was predicted, but then when this happened, we actually connected it back and said, okay, so this was cause of the other one happening. And basically, what was interesting for them was what percentage of the predicted alarms, predicted failures, will happen or happened, and how long after the prediction. And when we measure that, 60% of the things that we predicted that will fail really failed within 8 minutes after the prediction. And then 80% failed within 30 minutes after the prediction. And the data for training there, that's machine learning, the data was on 10 minutes window. So you were like training on 10 minutes and trying to predict what happens next based on available data. And then this was the predictions which happened. The other thing on the same real-time information processing. So you can see there is something that you need to handle data quickly. The other one was, again, the same story, but on logs. There was New York Times, which I mentioned, articles that people read, but also the log file. And based on article and the log files, you make user profile. And then this is ontogen screen. We have seen this today. Based on that, group similar users together. They are similar based on what they read and also based on the log file, which has cookie and has information if the user are registered, has information on gender, income, their address, interest, job position, and so on. And the idea was, once I can do the segments, and some segments of green energy was, hybrid cars, energy power model, that's what they were reading about. They can go and sell that, hopefully, to advertising companies saying, well, I know how to access my segment of users interested in green energy. I can serve just to them your advertisements. Well, I mentioned that some of the users are registered. We know their gender, age, income, but not all of them. I think it's 10% are registered, if they are. The other story for machine learning challenge here was, well, if I give you this 10% and their behavior, can you predict gender of these other users for which you don't know the gender or age, but you can measure similarity in behavior? You know how user of this gender and this age behave on my web pages. And we were doing experiments with that, and what turned out, basically, we could, maybe if I just show here, younger than 30 and older than 60, you can do prediction. The middle is difficult because, they're active, they work, and then it's difficult to say either over 40 or under 40 in that range, right? And this was the story about which features helped with that. The third story of this real-time information processing is for Bloomberg, which is news recommendation. User modeling based on what they read, from where they come. And then if you go on Bloomberg page, this more news is actually served also by our system, which is running online there. So these are the features for recommendation. It's history, which is user profile, which is these pages. What the user has read so far. But it's also, in addition to history, I have geo information based on IP of the user that comes now. I have requested page that the user requests now, and I have referring URL. I know from where the user came. And I have time. Is it morning? Is it afternoon? That usually kind of makes difference. Is it Sunday? Is it working day? And then for training, this was my training. I had this data and I trained to predict category, content category of the next news the user wants to read. And this is how it works. So we were predicting content category of a news and then inside the content category showing the most read news inside the category. So the prediction wasn't particular page, particular news that the user wants to read, but it was about what the user wants to read. So it was category, as I said, and these are the results. So again, I don't think it makes sense now to go into details of the results, but they're basically also for new users, the results are reasonable. So for those users for which we don't have history, but we have similarity to the other users. And this is what is behind. So there is real-time architecture. So there is login code visits, which are stored. There is index, which is updated. One is used for collaborative filtering in recommendation, one approach. The other one is used for SVM classification, which is another approach which is used, and the pages can be crawled, and then on the fly the model is of user interest is updated based on new pages that the user reads. You update the model because you learn more about the user and you do better recommendation. So here is just some research graph which is showing performance. Basically what it's showing is percentage, how many times users really clicked alive, users really clicked on what was recommended using different methods. And one method is, you can imagine our SEM, which was the best, is the best performing. It goes from 4 to 7% that the user click. This is time, how it goes. And this one is random. So if you randomly choose category, and then inside that randomly chosen category, you suggest to the user the most popular article, this is how the random. So in 2%, they will click on that random. And this is a collaborative filtering. And I didn't point out, but this one, the green one, was editor suggestion. That was what they had so far. So we compared, they ran extensive testing to compare. This is what we have so far. 1% of the users clicked on our recommendation. Can you do better? And then we came with few approaches which can do better, including random, which did better. And this is from the screen. I won't go online, but it is online. And this is from the screen, one user. What it says, it's user from Seattle with 3 visits before, coming from Bloomberg News and requesting a page which involves electric car technology. These are the recommendations. This is the user history. So the user read previously about General Motors, Renault Technology, Airbus, and this is what the user was recommended to read more based on this history. And this is another user which was an old user coming more times, 27 times. The user was searching on natural gases. And this is a recommendation. Oil, shipping rates, soybeans. And this is the user history about natural gas future, catastrophic, and so on. Okay, I will skip through this personalized search. This is another thing on the top of the same story, which is just saying I can re-rank based on the user profile. If I have young female computer programmer, I know that from the profile because user registered. If not, I predict that using machine learning. And here are the results when searching on religion. So it's angels and demons on the top. But if I have a middle-aged male searching on religion, I get different ranking of the same New York Times. And this is, that's it what I wanted to say research-wise. I just want to show you again video lectures, encourage you to go and check. There are many lectures there. And there is also Montreal there on video lectures because there was International Machine Learning Conference in 2009 here. And invited talks were recorded, so you can also go online for that. Thank you.
Thank you.